The engines on the Fat Controller's railway noticed more and more railway enthusiasts visiting the island of Sodor than ever before. They all came with cameras and stood in fields, on bridges, or at the end of station platforms to photograph the engines. Most of the engines enjoyed being in the spotlight, especially James. But the engine they were here to see didn't. Richard's fast timings pulling the boat train had caught some attention. So much so that the Sodor Locomotive Society wanted to arrange a special train for Richard to haul. The Fat Controller agreed. But Richard wished he hadn't.
"I'm not too keen on enthusiasts," he admitted reluctantly to the others. "They don't wave on the bridges like other people do."
"That's because they're holding their cameras," chuckled James. "I mean, I'm ready for my close-up, but not if it means them dropping their camera on my face."
"There's a lot of pressure to do things right," explained Richard. "They can be very fussy and picky at times. They write things down about performances or appearances in little notebooks and publish them in magazines, you know."
"In that case, you should put on a show," suggested Gordon. "Power and speed is what they're after."
"No, ignore him. Looking good is what they want. You have to look the part."
"No, make as much noise as you can," insisted Percy. "Enthusiasts say I have the best whistle in your dreams. Just you listen."
"Have you quite finished?" "Please, Richard, do not concern yourself. Enthusiast specials are just the same as any other ordinary passenger train."
"Well, I suppose so," sighed Richard. "But something is bound to go wrong. It always does."
"Well, what will be. But," smiled Edward, remembering from his own experience, "the important thing is that trains must get through. We endeavour to make sure that they do so." Edward puffed away, leaving Richard with a lot to think about. The day of the enthusiast special arrived. When Richard pulled into the station, the platform was crowded with photographers. They all wanted a picture of Richard. They surrounded him, and Richard was dazzled by flashing camera lights from all different directions. He didn't know which way to look. In the end, he hissed loudly and shrouded himself in steam. This stopped the photographers, and they grumbled as they boarded the train. When the steam cleared, there stood the Fat Controller.
"Feeling camera shy?" he asked.
Oh, sir, I'm so sorry, sir. I didn't mean to hiss so much steam.
Don't enjoy being relentlessly photographed?"
"I can see that, Richard. But I agree to this special because you will undoubtedly put in a fine performance and make a lot of these enthusiasts very happy. Now, take a breather, have a good run, and above all, enjoy yourself."
"But what if I do something wrong and they say bad things about me, sir?" asked Richard.
"Then you will leave them to me," smiled the Fat Controller. That made Richard feel better.
The Fat Controller was right. Richard did indeed put in a fine performance. So well, in fact, he forgot to be worried about the enthusiasts. There were many lined up along the line side, filming and taking his picture as he flew by. Richard raced through Edward's station, whistling happily at the old engine as he passed by. "Be careful on the hill," warned Edward. "There are showers expected later."
"Thank you," called Richard as he hurried out of sight.
As he sped towards Gordon's Hill, Richard dropped sand on the rails.
He climbed the hill effortlessly. By the time he arrived at the other end of the line, Richard was feeling very relieved.
"Ooh, that wasn't so bad after all," he said to himself.
As the enthusiasts flocked out of the train, it began to rain. Richard was glad of this. They didn't want to get wet, so stood close to the station building. "Come on," said the driver, "let's get you to the turntable ready for the return journey." When Richard reached the turntable, there was trouble. "The mechanism is jammed solid," explained the yardmaster. "We're trying to fix it, but it won't budge. You'll have to run back tender first." "Well, there goes our fast run back home," grumbled the driver.
"Oh dear," groaned Richard.
He dreaded to think what the enthusiasts would say.
"Oh, look at this. Richard's going tender first," said one.
"Fancy not having a working turntable," said another, and took more photographs.
Richard quietly buffered up to the coaches without a word, and when all was ready, steadily departed. The rain stopped just as Richard approached Gordon's Hill. Travelling tender first meant Richard couldn't go very fast. His run-up was slow, and he quickly lost his grip on the damp rails. The fireman dropped the sand, but it did no good.
"Sand, please, fireman," puffed Richard.
"I'm doing just that," the fireman replied.
Richard slipped again. The heavy coaches strained on his coupling, and Richard's wheels began spinning helplessly.
Don't stop! Not here!
Cried Richard strenuously. The train shuddered to a halt halfway up the hill. Richard tried to restart the train, but his wheels spun and he couldn't move. The enthusiasts all leaned out of the windows to see what the commotion was about.
"Well, I knew something like this would happen," sobbed Richard. "Now they'll all make a fuss about how badly I've performed."
The guard walked up to the cab.
"What happened here then?" he asked.
"I might have an idea," said the driver, pointing to the rails under the train. "Look." Sand had been deployed, but Richard's sandpipes were positioned only in front of his leading driving wheels. Effective when running forwards, but useless for going backwards. The enthusiast seemed anxious. So too was Richard. Driver, fireman, and guard walked ahead of the train, sanding the rails to the summit.
"Do your best, Richard," encouraged the driver. "If you do stall again, don't worry too much. We'll end up having to call for a banker."
Richard didn't want to delay his train any longer.
"Well, I'll give it my best shot," he said.
Richard restarted cautiously. The train creaked and groaned as he backed slowly up the hill. He slipped suddenly, but the driver immediately brought it under control.
Come on, huffed Richard.
The enthusiasts started to cheer for him out of the carriage windows.
"Go on, Richard.
Keep going there, old boy. You can do it, Richard. Go on, son."
Steam erupted into the air. Richard snorted furiously up the hill. The sound was deafening. He dug his wheels into the sand, and with one last huge effort, Richard crested the top of the hill. The whole train cheered and shouted for Richard.
"Well done, you brilliant engine," exclaimed the driver. "Just listen to that."
"Is it for me?" "Thank you very much."
It was getting late. Edward stood at the big station with the fat controller.
He was anxiously pacing the platform and looking at the clock. In the distance, there came a whistle. Richard steamed into view. The Fat Controller hurried round to check on him. He was met by a sea of cheering and clapping enthusiasts. They thanked Richard and his crew and sang their praises to the Fat Controller. In the face of adversity, Richard didn't give up. He performed remarkably and is a true credit to your railway, they all said. The Fat Controller chuckled with delight. I'm certainly glad to hear it. Amongst the jubilation, Edward spoke quietly to Richard. A fine performance getting your train home.
Well, it's just like you said. Trains must get through, said Richard.
Edward smiled. Well done, Richard. I am very proud of you. Richard was ecstatic. He couldn't think of any other engine he'd rather hear such praise than from Edward, the Blue Engine. That night, the engines were intrigued to hear about the enthusiast special.
How did it go? Inquired James.
Yeah, it went all right, Richard said simply.
Just all right. Poof. Enthusiast trains are wasted on you. I should have pulled that train.
You'd have only stuck on the hill.
Yeah, well, you got there first. That's why it's forever named after you.
Pah, snorted Gordon.
Richard and Edward laughed knowingly to each other. Then, whilst the engines bickered, Richard closed his eyes and went contentedly to sleep.
What's impossible, will they forget? This world keeps spinning and with each new day I can feel a change in everything. And as the surface breaks, reflections fade. But in some ways they remain the same. And as my mind begins to spread its wings, there's no stopping curiosity. I wanna turn the whole thing upside down. I'll find the things they say just can't be found. I'll share this love I find with everyone. We'll sing and dance to Mother Nature's songs. I don't want this feeling to go away. I can't do everything, well I can try. And as I roll along I begin to find things aren't always just what they seem. I wanna turn the whole thing upside down. I'll find the things they say just can't be found. I'll share this love I find with everyone. We'll sing and dance song. This world keeps spinning and there's no time to waste. Well, it all keeps spinning, spinning round and round and up. Please don't go away. Please don't go away. Please don't go away. Is this how it's supposed to be? Is this how it's supposed to be?
Dear friends, despite what many assume, our Fat Controller is a kind man. He prefers steam, but sees the value in all engines, regardless of their type. Nowhere is this more evident than his willingness to give Bear another chance, while also saving Oliver from scrap. Many engines dream of calling the Island of Sodor their home. Dudley was determined to make it his reality. These stories will tell you what happened. Sincerely, the author.